Thanks for the invitation. Thanks for the opportunity to lodge for two nights in the Queen's Room of Emmanuel College, looking at the beautiful garden of the fellows. Though I couldn't find any symmetry in this garden. That's typical for English gardens, I think. But it has a famous Oriental plane tree. And I have to thank Lucia Ruprecht that she took care of me for 3 days, and of course Anna Malinowska. Because giving this talk, I have to clarify two things. Firstly, speaking on pain, I'll concentrate on physical pain. So, forgot mental suffering for a moment. I know that it's sometimes hard to tell the difference. Secondly, if I speak about cultural studies, I don't refer to the famous British Birmingham school, say Raymond Williams or Stuart Hall. The German Kulturwissenschaft is a sort of stage on which different disciplines of the humanities exchange their knowledge, the same as CRASSH does, I think. So, methodological, it is characterized by a mixture of discourse analysis, historical anthropology, media theory, and history of science, so the only way to bridge the gap between humanities and sciences. And all methods are under the spell of the linguistic term, as you will see. So, is there any fairness in relation to pain? Is there any fairness in representation of pain? Can a phenomenon which is resisting representation be an object of beauty? So to try to connect the two keynotes. In a postscript to his book One Way Street, Einbahnstraße, published in 1928, Walter Benjamin writes, you've got all on the handout, so my pronunciation will be no barrier. So Walter Benjamin writes, would not every illness, be curable if it has allowed itself to flow into the sufficiently wide, deep stream of narrative? More light is shed on the matter if you keep in mind that pain cannot be narrated, that to a certain extent it works like a dam blocking up the juices of life, Lebenssäfte in German, juices of life that long to join us, to join as tributaries to the great epic river of being. If you keep in mind that pain cannot be narrated. So Benjamin, in 1928, already had read Elaine Scarry's Body of Pain. Benjamin's observation hits at the very heart of a heated debate within today's cultural studies in Germany, Austria, Switzerland. It objects to the mainstream idea that has held sway over cultural studies in the last decade, and which one might summarize in the claim that physical pain, too, is a cultural construct. Physical pain has become the subject of a highly revealing difference of opinion involving medical practitioners, neuroscientists, cognitive psychologists, sociologists, literary scholars, and philosophers. The extreme poles of this struggle to define pain can be summed up as follows. Firstly, physical pain disrupts all signifying systems. It is not affected by any cultural grammar. Pain is an index of the pre-discursive body. In pain, the body casts off the stigma of mediation. And secondly, the opposing side of the debate is equally resolute. All the ways in which humans express pain stem from an old archive of rhetorical formula. If pain appears to be an attack on the unmediated nature of the body, this is nothing more than a mediatic effect. Even in the name of pain, we are limited to extracts from the archive. It is clear that we are dealing with two quite distinct phenomena here. The first is a physiologically determined sensation, the other, the forms of performance relating to pain. In this sense, the two standpoints could in fact work beside one another. If it were made clear how the communication of pain and the sensation in the individual's world of experience conduct themselves in relation to one another. This raises the further question as to whether cultural studies have anything at all to say about pain beyond the forms of its expression. I'm of the opinion that there are things in the world about which cultural studies would do well to remain silent, because cultural studies are not qualified to deal with all topics. The cultural studies term. In 1991, the book Culture of Pain was published by David B. Morris, former professor of English literature at the University of Iowa. And in 1995 came the Anthropology of Pain by the Strasbourg sociologist David Le Breton, was published. The fourth chapter of Le Breton's books carries the provocative title The Social Construction of Pain. Both books raise the question, can a physiological sensation be socially constructed? And both of these cultural theorists answer the question with arguments that I will reproduce there in a simplified form. First, pain cannot be defined as a purely physiological reaction. The sensation that an individual experiences are not direct impressions left to the consciousness by the injury. Pain is not experienced proportionally to the injury's severity. The human body never works in a biological vacuum. Rather, it is plotted by a scheme of social and cultural symbols. Secondly, every society has integrated pain into its worldview and has assigned a meaning to it that takes away its hard immediacy. The collective meaning that is given to pain and the ritual displays by which it is communicated to others are likewise symbolic defense mechanisms that we fall back on in order to bring our suffering under control. Both Morris and Le Breton illustrate their standpoints with numerous case studies. I would now like to take you on a short journey through the literature on pain, which I will begin at the end of the 19th century. This is because I'm interested in examining Elaine Scarry's important thesis that physical pain is a material that resists language. I'm thinking of a phrase that Paul Valéry wrote as far back at the end of the 19th century in his Cahiers. Pain has no meaning. It is a phrase that overturns multiple discourses on pain of several centuries. It indicates the end, for the moment, of a process of reduction. Over the course of the 19th century, the empirical sciences had gradually liberated pain from the bound of Christian interpretation. Only then could pain be reduced to a physiological event, to an electrical signal that shoots through the nerves. At this time, too, the first narratives began to circulate in which pain had only one meaning, namely nothing. Let's begin with a well-known story, Against the Grain, by Yuriska Wismont from 1884. Let us imagine a man whose work consists mainly in separating himself with all his senses from his environment in order to sun himself in the artificial existence of a pathetic. This would all be well and good if he were not sensitive to pain all over his body. This man in this paradoxical condition is the hero of Wismont's novel Against the Grain, published in 1884. The book was immediately both celebrated and trashed as a Bible of decadence. After years of chaotic urbanity, the hero has turned away from the vault, bought a neighborless room far from Paris, and furnished it to his eccentric taste. And this abode, so he says, he need fear neither the thunderbolt of love nor that of religion. He plays it safe. Yes. As it soon becomes clear, he is not quite safe here from the thunderbolt of pain. There can be no doubt as to the oversensitive nature of the man, especially when he discovers that since his earliest youth, he has been tormented by an inexplicable revulsion, a kind of shudder, which rippled, lay over his back, and made his teeth knock together when he saw how a housemaid wrung out the wet laundry. Even before this, the hero suffered from sporadic fits of pain, which he was, however, able to allay with the help of opium by disappearing into the anonymity of the crowd. For the rest, he comforts himself with the knowledge that pain is a result of one's upbringing. Common whining is decidedly beneath him. To numb painful sensation of nerves, he invents strange simulation games, for instance, exaggerated trembling, in order, so to speak, to give pain a mechanical outlet. Above all, he seeks a cure in the library. He draws his diet from its bookshelves. How could Baudelaire and Mallarmé not be a redeeming balm for body and soul? Indeed, he experiences both of their writings as a distilled concentrate of literature. Admittedly, these means, unfortunately, lost their effect as soon as his sufferings were real ones. While these descriptions transport us back to the artificial paradise of the décadent in the 1880s, the characterization of the hero's bodily sensation could very well come from a pain diagnosis from a checklist such as those used by the doctors of today to trace the sources of pain, the pain drill, as we read, the pain drilled through his temples, or drives wooden stakes into his neck, or cuts his face in two. From time to time he doth sink beneath the level of the acid, however, as when during a dental extraction he began to bleed like an animal at slaughter. This all points a subliminal mechanism, one that underlies the fine cultural fabric in which a hero wraps himself. This mechanism is no mystery. As the novel shows, it can be translated quite effortlessly into the idiom of the medical profession. In fact, our hero now meets a brave representative of the traditional school of medicine of that time, and it is he who first succeeds in curing, at least temporarily, the stomach neurosis of the sensitive character by means of a steam cooker, one that distills real concentrate. And because any contact with the outside world would be unthinkable to this lonely hero, this therapy actually suits him quite well. A talking cure would naturally be the last thing that this lover of distance would want. He is in luck. The doctor who comes to his rescue is pleasingly taciturn, does not want to hear any stories, but instead sets about closely observing the man's urine, in which certain white streaks indicated one of the central causes of the neurosis. He made out a prescription and left without a word, signaling that he would be back soon. This doth the hero good. What horror would have been taken hold of him if he had been met with a doctor of the Freud's era, who would have wanted to treat him as a talking patient? No, the acid is in luck. The pepton enema that is described, prescribed to him, pleases him beyond all measure. This is because it is a technical apparatus with the purpose of artificial nourishment. The efficacy of the cure is considerable. His stomach promptly decides to function again. So far, so good. On the other hand, his recovery is seriously compromised when it is recommended to him, in accordance with the opinion of honorary specialists, to return to communal life. because the spiritual side of the illness does not fall within the chemical powers of medicine. He who can understand Mallarmé and Valéry must return to the lowly world in which consecrated alms is corrupted with poultry fat and communion hosts are produced from potato flour. He shudders at the thought. Disgust, the ultimate effect of proximity, takes hold of him. In Wismond's novel of 1884, we witness a short circuit between the neurotic lifestyle and the work of the physiologist. One man tries here to set up his life in an artificial realm and falls unceremoniously into the realm of medicine. Pain works in this narrative like a switch. Flip it, and the toxic illumination of the fin de siècle can be turned at any moment to the fluorescent light of medical discovery. Now, the second pain story we find in Paul Valéry, Monsieur Tech's Test from 1893. Ten years after the publication of Wismond's novel, another writer discerns a different way of dealing with pain. Paul Valéry dips into the medical discourse of the nerves and gives it a stoic twist. He imagines that the nervous system could possess a special relay which would provide it with a safety catch that in cases of overexcitement or when it is so desired, cuts the connection between the centers and the causes of emotions and switches disturbance to a neutral setting. This is a solution Paul Valéry finds in 1893 for his test subject Edmond Test. In contrast to the sumptuous interior designs of Huysmans' hero, Test lives in squalor. We find him in a small, barely furnished apartment, in the greenish room that smelled of mint, and the cheerless, abstract furniture was arranged around the candle. Bed, clock, mirrored wardrobe, two armchairs. As if they were sentient beings. In short, a frosty chamber, pure and distinct, a Cartesian logic. Monsieur Test works on the assumption that the intensity of feeling is not suited to being shared with between people. Spontaneous expressions of passions do not exalt the human being. On the contrary, they render man ordinary. Only the power of intellect can serve as a mark of distinction. Test is a man who observes the world around him with a gaze of separation, one who exudes extreme cold, and who even in a dire situation doesn't complain, but prefers to count the buttons of the hangman jacket. Does such a model of a reflexive coldness allow him weakness? From time to time he permits himself to laugh, which consists for him, as Madame Test reports, as being able to be terribly foolish with one another, with all the freedom for stupidity and bestiality. Test is concerned, above all, that the sovereignty of his rational thought should be derailed by anything. One can sense the unhappy ending. It's approaching. One evening after a trip to the theater, Monsieur Test suddenly falls silent. He was suffering pain. Then we get to observe Monsieur Test going to bed. He undressed without hurry, his gaunt body was bathed in the bed sheets and looked dead. Then he turned and dived deeper into the bed that was too short for him. Test begins a monologue on his perception of his body as a child, insisting on the claim that he knows himself inside and out, physically too, and declaring his love for the familiar linen sheet that would wrap itself around him, like scent, if he were to feign death. Until, his speech falters as he suddenly feels a snag in the fabric of the sheet that envelops him. Valéry marks the interruption in the text with an ellipsis. It's nothing special, says the hero. At most, a coincidence, which lasts no longer than tenths of a second and therefore cannot be anything permanent. The repetition of the ellipses, which indicate interruption of throbbing pain, lent the text to a certain rhythm. Nothing more. Emptiness of expression reigns, and sleep is desired. The interruption of the in the text do not shed any light on existential chasms or obscure areas of the psyche. Neither psychoanalysis nor other therapists who deal with pain will find anything to get excited about here. When pain suddenly erupts, it does not illuminate any past. It sheds light only on the parts of the body that are present. It provokes local resistance and reduces consciousness to a brief present tense, to a moment of constriction robbed of future horizon. Well, these sentences are too good. They are quotations. The last two sentences were quotations from the conclusions of Jan Storobinski. With these lines written in 1984, he captured the quintessence of the evening with Monsieur Test and concurred with Valéry's verdict: the intensity of pain should be measured in opposition to the freedom that it leaves us to express it. He invites us to accept with Valéry the limits of psychoanalysis, and he cites Freud, who, after having a ball removed, wrote to Fleece, his friend, that the sensation material of this pain could not be mastered in narrative. It hurts too much. In Test's story, pain finds no expression, except the three ellipses, which refer to reality beyond the world of science. Wordlessly, it frustrates the aspiration of the hero to be the lord over his own thoughts. Extreme physical pain is, according to the logic of the text, split off from the psyche as a local bodily sensation. In contrast to neurosis, this physical pain has no narrative configuration, despite all efforts of meaning-making. Such pain, as Valéry says, has no meaning. Pain has no meaning. This succinct phrase marks the historical endpoint of a process by which pain was released from its traditional cultural encoding. For the first time, pain appeared as a resistant to language. Yet the very possibility of formulating such a phrase relied on a tremendous clear-up operation in the 19th century. Physiologists and anatomists seemed definitely to have writ the cultural body of Christian semantics. And Valéry's phrase, pain has no meaning, stands in close proximity, I think, to Nietzsche's dictum, God is dead. With these words, our bones feel the chill of the universe. Valéry expresses an unbearable thought, or rather, a thought which makes of its unbearability an index of the truth. Now, nothing remains of pain as a dull resistance, which, as Valéry writes, places consciousness in opposition to a local disposition of the body. The erasure of the Christian meaning of pain that dated back in the 1880s and 90s and sketched out here in rough sets the scene for the cultural approach to pain that will dominate in the 20th century. The reinterpretation of pain as a medium of contact with the very basis of being in the First World War. When the famous, so speaking in Germany, the very famous surgeon Ferdinand Sauerbruch and the philosopher Hans Wenck published the text Pain, Its Meaning and Significance in 1936, they were able to look back over a time of immense suffering as a result of the First World War. The Weimar Republic had been an epoch in which one had to come to terms with two opposing positions. The war had provided an incentive to make sense of pain, but defeat had delivered the people over to the unbearable certainty that all suffering had been in vain. Scientific thought at the time offered a different conception of pain. The Republic's opponents, however, were ununited in the conviction that liberalism could offer nothing more than a narcotic. Strangely enough, in Sauerbruch und Wenke, a chapter, Medicinal Discovery About Pain, the war is only mentioned in the context of an astounding phenomenon of pain reduction, which surgeons of the time used to call wound stupor. Whoever was charged as a doctor in the field with the task of caring for our brave comrades knows from observing hundreds of cases that many who suffer the stress and exertion of their service, the grueling effects of a constant suspense and danger, of concussion and shock, lost themselves. In such cases, the mind couldn't even stretch to the primitive vegetative function of life. For those in this condition, there was no space left to feel pain. In this way, it was possible to carry out necessary procedures without the use of anesthetics. Sauerbruch shows through the example of a lieutenant that this psychological wound stupor is not only a sign of exhaustion, but also a side effect of heroism. This man was so agitated by the danger posed by a nighttime shock troop that he hardly notifies the amputation of his arm, which was carried out without anesthetics. The fact that the surgeon concentrates on this form of pain reduction when recalling his experiences of attrition warfare may be symptomatic of the two decades following the war, marked, as it were, by a desire for immunity against pain. The author's link to the fascination of the wound stupor phenomenon, on the one hand, with the old Prussian ideal of a soldier's education, and on the other, with Nietzsche's thesis on pain as a species-preserving value. But they seem, above all, to be caught in the spell of Anzinger's text on pain, which was published 3 years earlier. They write that pain appears in Jünger's work as an actual origin of life. Discipline is described by Jünger as the form in which the human being comes into contact with pain, and in this way maintains contact with the elementary realm of life. Ernst Jünger had wanted to cleanse perception of pain of any kind of empathy. He recommended seeking out the front line of suffering and there to toughen one's apathy and ability to cast a cold gaze upon pain. It's tempting to judge Jünger's essay as a symptom of soldierly apathy, but I'm more interested in the clear-sighted diagnosis that he makes of the Weimar Republic liberalism. For Jünger, liberalism is a societal form that drives pain out of heart of society to the edges, where, in clinics, prisons, and barracks, the specialists of pain do their work, but the mass media feed images of pain into the society's interior, where they are consumed like drugs. The stoic mind has little role to play here. The splitting of pain is entrusted to a flood of technical images that appear in popular magazines. Ataraxia produces itself of its own accord in the mass media. The new media become machines for the disposal of empathy. When Martin Heidegger read Jünger's treatise on pain during the Second World War, he noted that the text at no point actually deals with pain. Though Jünger describes pain as an element of the will of power, he fantasizes himself as a homo militaris on the level of the commander. Heidegger remarked, Jünger writes throughout in the language of the Wehrmacht report. The level of the commander is a position from which he believes he can command pain as an object. The text does not approach the being of pain, but rather an attitude or ethos which makes pain the touchstone of heroism. Could we not just, well, as Heidegger, give this kind of heroism a trivial name, such as numbness, ignorance, or indifference? In He never published this, of course. Junger was a friend. Junger has never found himself at mercy with pain, Heidegger remarked, the way one is at mercy with the will of power. Rather, he empties out pain in order to turn the social attitude to pain into a cultural value. This is why there comes, at the end, the deadwood of all dying metaphysics. The words of Heidegger. Sinngebung, meaninggebung. And that was the last thing you could do from the perspective of Heidegger. Heidegger uncovers how Junger remains within the discourse of the neusachliche Sentimentalität, as a sentimentality of new objectivity, by distancing himself from the harshness and coldness demanded by the world of the bourgeois emotionalism. His discourse, in fact, never loses its attachment to that world. Thus, it should not be surprised that Heidegger describes the search for meaning in pain in the pain treatise as a form of narcosis in itself, which still today is seen by conservative cultural critics as a sign of shallow liberalism. Junger only deals with a misconceived metaphysical narcosis. The movement against pain is a movement toward the oblivion of absolute meaninglessness. For Heidegger, the visible symptom of the oblivion is that everything in Junger's boils down is the suit of armor. On the eve of Monsieur Tess's publication in 1893, pain has made its literary debut as a language-resistant material in the relatively harmless milieu of the thought experiment and its medical debut on the realm of neuralgia. In the 20th century, the methods of inflicting pain exceeded any previously known in history. But anybody who talks today on pain as a language-resistant matter cuts or provokes the attacks of the cultural theorists in German. Communication theorists, analytic philosophers, medics, and media theorists ward off the thought of a language-resistant material as decisively as therapists working with pain, who have learned in the clinics to value the meaning of the language of pain. One thing is clear. As an extra-linguistic event, pain cannot form the object of a cultural studies. That is, as long as the latter remains concentrated on discourses of pain. When pain is communicated, its communication is governed by cultural codes. But do these codes then rub off on pain itself? In 1985, Elaine Scarry's book The Body in Pain was published. In the archive of Amnesty International, she uncovered a whole database of pain, secret service protocols, torture memoirs, and medical diagnoses. Analyzing them, Scarry comes to the conclusion that extreme pain is defined by incommunicability. It does not only resist language, it also destroys it. It unmakes the world. Pain is not at or from anything. Pain is just pain. Definitely, pain cannot be captured in the world via the media of symbolic construction. This is because pain signifies a loss of world. Scarry illustrates these facts with a plausible sketch. When we speak, the ego reaches beyond the boundaries of the body and occupies a space that is greater than that of the body. Extreme physical pain, however, destroys the possibility of symbolically increasing one's personal space. This space is rather reduced by pain to the pure presence of the body. Along with these loss of the capacity for objectivation in an extended personal space, the individual affected also falls out of the sphere of intersubjective exchange. Robbed of this capacity for symbolic space creation, the person in pain opened him or herself, up to power. For the agents of power, the victim's whole emotional world thus becomes an externalized map, which they can then use according to their aims. Elaine Scarry stood nearly alone in this argument in the sphere of German cultural studies, which was dominated by discourse analysis. Her critics made some relevant points, I think. Le Breton, for instance, stated that an individual never simply saves up the sensations he or she has felt, but rather transforms them into his or her own categories, which he or her, she shares with peers, but which also bear his or her own personal mark. And Jacob Tanner, a historical anthropologist from Zurich, stresses in his review, always, and not only in the cases of extreme pain, a chasm opens up between the silence of the real body and the discourses of the symbolically constructed body. This chasm cannot be bridged by anything, but in dialogue with one another, individuals have made the life world with the share with other their own. And it is one in which they make their own body experience comprehensible to others. Media theorists would ask how it could be explained that Elaine Scarry was able to make an image of the victim's loss of the world from archives of texts. I'm sure you know this argument. Huh? They argue in the moment of its depiction, pain is linguistically construction. These constructions are stored in texts, preserved in archives, later on, subtextual archives, can be brought back to life as we wish. Linguistic forms in which pain is communicated are relatively stereotypical. Despite the validity of these points, this does not mean that pain dissolves itself when it is mediated as part of a cultural archive. While there exists an astoundingly stereotypical arsenal of figures of speech relating to pain, all these figures refer to a reality of sensation whose sheer presence is turned into a stereotype because the power of individual expression has been taken away from the individual in pain. I'd like to finish by illustrating the crux of the debate about pain and its evidence with the use of two documents. Heiko Christian wrote an excellent piece of scholarly work in 1999 in which he investigates the archive of European literature on the topic of pain. He examined the means by which the effect of evidence of pain is produced over time. He discovers in the process an astoundingly continuous discursive field with an uncannily limited rhetorical repertoire. The archives are full of texts in which pain rips like lightning through the fabric of speech, without revealing anything real underneath, but only the fabric of another speech. Science, and that's not a linguistic term, science refer to science. Listen to this extreme position. In the moment of its depiction, pain is a construct only ever communicable as a text. Even extreme pain that is hardly interrupted by the wavering or moment of ease, which reports agree can break bones, locks the sufferer in this way. The victim, who is thus plagued, described as having eyes that are torn open, or as a shrill, squealing piglet at slaughter, find itself, himself, in a sea of fictions. When a person curls up from pain, like an animal on the floor, and can no longer make the distinction constitutive of his place in the world of living being, of upright gait and articulate speech, the change of language rattle even louder. So he's in the archive, he's imprisoned in the archive. The expression, shrill squealing of piglet at slaughter, is taken from Jean Amery's memoirs of his torture, which he suffered in July 1943 at the hands of the Gestapo in Brussels. Amery's essay, written in 1964, corresponds to the linguistic sensation of Elaine Scarry's theoretically explored two decades later. Extreme pain, as Amery reports, destroys the individual ability to increase the symbolic space of his or her body. In this case, too, following the loss of trust in the world, the tortured individual world of sensation works as an externalized map open for others to access. Amélie remembers crying out at the culmination of the torture like a shrill, squealing piglet at slaughter. There is no doubt the work of linguistic reconstruction forces Amélie to draw this animal image card from the archive of expressions about pain. Why should we find anything strange about this? Torture involves total removal from the social world. In the reconstruction of memory, Amélie draws the animal image card. It refers to an event that was and remains subhuman and resistant to language. The pain was what it was, said Amélie. Admittedly, his reflection work through his reflections work through a rhetorical device which factors in an understanding of the mediate nature of what it is being expressed. Naturally, says Amélie, the individual must orient himself or herself in the world of formula. He makes over 20 hints and suggestions of the communicative patterns relating to pain, from the etymological origin of the word torture to interviews with torture victims that you read in the Neue Weltbühne in the 30s, before his imprisonment. He read Graham Greene's commentaries on photographs of torture in Vietnam, criminological treatises on tortures in Algeria, Hannah Arendt's Eichmann in Jerusalem, and physiological texts by a professor of surgery on the Collège de France. These symbolic frameworks surround him. They belong to a familiar textual environment, which offered itself as a way of grasping the actual process of torture and to reconstruct it in retrospect. But in extreme pain, this wall of science is smashed in order to provide evidence of this loss of world through pain. Amélie stages a breakdown of the formula stored in the archive. It would be totally senseless to try and describe here the pain that was inflicted on me. It was like a red hot iron in my shoulders, and was another like a dull wooden stake that had been driven into the back of my head. One comparison would only stand for the other, and in the end we would be hoaxed by turn on the hopeless merry-go-round figurative speech. The pain was what it was. Beyond that, there's nothing to say. But Amélie actually says a lot here. He makes the event present precisely by citing a chain of useless formula, showcasing the failing registers of language in order to portray the event as an experience that goes beyond the archive. The event of pain is revealed as a trap door in the library. In this imagined fall, Amélie found the card with the image of the animal on it, and it was one of the card indexes of the catalogue of affects. He needs this so that, in the middle of the archive, he can refer to an unarchivable experience. So Elaine Scarry is right. For this experience of pain, Valéry's Cartesian formula can apply. It illuminates only zones of the body, reduces consciousness, does not shed light on the past, robs the horizon, and reduces the individual to the pure presence of the body. Amélie thinks this is to its radical end, although he alludes to Heidegger and Bataille and Sartre. Nowadays we would allude to Agamben, I think. So, although he alludes to Heidegger, Bataille and Sartre, he refuses to burden the event with an existentialist interpretation. His experience of pain is not suited to being dissolved as an example of awareness of actual being within the existentialist narrative. So why not stay a while longer in Monsieur Tess's frosty chamber? Because from meaning nothing, pain has now come to light as a mechanical phenomenon, something that could already be deduced from Wismore's use in line with the physiologists in the 19th century of the vocabulary of drilling, cutting, and driving. Pain here is nothing but a psychically inflected sensory impulse, an impulse to move, which meets with resistance because all exits are blocked. A mechanical phenomenon whose meaningless is not symbolically charged by such figures of speech as going up the wall, but it's only mimetically rearticulated by them. I go up the wall. In their mechanical acts, Monsieur Tess and his small hero find something in common. As he recounts, Monsieur Tess also expects the scream with which he could dupe himself in order to take leave of his senses. And in both cases, pain leads not to symbolic expression, but to movements in which the self is lost in utter presence. And so the topic of dance is coming in the context of this speech on pitch, pain. This model seems to explain very little, but perhaps it can explain why the 20th century, the age of extreme pain, has been stamped with the signatures of loss of world and bleak isolation, and why trauma has become the byword for a pain that does not allow us to take leave of our senses and which cannot be attenuated by any symbolic practice. So, thank you.